this on?
Hi there.
Hello, everybody. It is now 3:15, and hopefully, if you're looking for the session on branding internet-facing sites, this is the one that you're looking for. If not, we're going to be talking in this session about branding topics, and I had a couple questions while everybody was coming in and sitting down about would we be covering on-prem branding as well as in the cloud, and so the answer to that before we kind of get too far is absolutely yes. Everything that we're going to be talking about today is going to cover both, is going to cover on-prem as well as Office 365 public sites.
All the demos will be in 365 online.
Right.
And there'll be some slides where we talk about things that are different between the public site and online. That'll be the only place where things diverge.
But hopefully we want to keep this as broad as possible, and so we're going to give you a little bit of idea about what you can do in the public sites, but we're also going to try to give you some information about where the line might be if you're trying to make a decision about which platform is going to be right for you. But without further ado, though, this is SPC 290. So as you're listening to the presentation and as you're hearing stuff, please feel free to reach out on Twitter or reach out on Yammer. Use a hashtag SPC290 and let us know what you think.
We won't be able to answer you while the session's going on, though.
Yeah, unfortunately we don't have that ability. But we thought generally whenever we present together, some of you may have seen us before. We present together quite often, and we actually live very close to each other, which is unusual in the SharePoint community. But we live approximately 12 minutes away, and we know this because I go pick him up for lunch, and he has it timed so that he meets me outside. But
it's kind of pathetic, actually.
Yeah, it's kind of true, though. So this is Randy Driscoll. I'm going to introduce him because it's more fun that way. This is Randy Driscoll. He is from Orlando, Florida, just like me, just like we talked about. He has a beard.
I do.
So that's an important thing that whenever we hang out all the time or we walk through the halls of SharePoint Conference, nobody recognizes me, but everybody says hi to him.
Somebody say hi to John.
At the last SharePoint Conference in Anaheim, when we were at the attendee party in Disneyland, there was even somebody that recognized him in the bathroom, which is probably not the right place to come up to somebody. Just FYI. But
you could recognize me there, but just don't recognize me.
But we, Randy and myself have actually worked on a couple books. The most recent one is SharePoint 2013, Branding and UI Design. Anybody here happen to pick it up? All right. It is. If you haven't and you're interested, there's a couple people that asked about it. We don't actually have any. It's available for sale out in the bookstore. It's full color, so it's one of the only books that's out there that's full color, so you can have all your pictures of delicious waffles and everything out there. So check it out. Also did a 2010 book as well. Reach out to Randy through his blog and on Twitter. Like I said, feel free to. We're talking with some other folks that if you've learned things throughout some of the sessions and you want to reach out and kind of show us some of the cool things that you've done with, you know, Randy's starter master page or whatever, say hi on Twitter. Post a screenshot. We'd love to see it.
This guy over here is John Ross, technical product manager at Rackspace, which means he deals with product stuff, of course. He does not have a beard. Some folks say he looks like a lamer Matt Damon. I don't know if I agree or disagree with that, but he gets his feelings hurt because no one ever says hi to him, so feel free to say hi to him in the hallways. But he worked on the same books as I did, some of the less hard chapters he helped out on.
That's so harsh.
That's not true at all. He worked on hard chapters too. But there's his blog there, John Ross Jr., his Twitter, et cetera, et cetera. Feel free to reach out to him. He just did a blog post the other day on the difference between on-prem and farm and cloud and all that kind of jazz.
Did you?
No, I did not read it. Of course, yeah. I didn't.
Well, I'm gonna talk about the blog post later on. But
all right. Well,
let's kind of get into it. I sort of alluded to what it is we're going to talk about, but this is, you know, the actual, you know, in college they tell you to make an agenda slide, so this is what it looks like. We're going to start off and we're going to talk about just branding in general. Branding is this word that has been attached to making things pretty in SharePoint or in websites in general, and we want to introduce that concept so that when we say the word branding, we kind of understand how it applies to not only marketing in general, but to SharePoint. We're going to go in and we're going to do an introduction to SharePoint Online public sites. What are they? And we're going to give a little tour of that. But then The thing that Randy and I have done over the years is we found that whenever that everybody wants, everybody's interested in branding. Everybody's interested in making their site not look like SharePoint. And so we've broken the tiers out of the way that you make your stuff not look like SharePoint into three tiers: low, medium, and high. Not hard, it's high. Mm. And so we're gonna talk about that, and we're gonna talk to you about what's involved in doing at each one of those levels, so that you can see and you can kind of understand what you're getting into. Depending on your requirements, you can figure out what level you need to be at. But then from a SharePoint perspective, especially with the Office 365 and SharePoint 2013, the way that you add new functionality is with apps. So we're gonna talk about how you add additional functionality to your SharePoint sites using apps, and going to show you some examples of the Office 365 apps that are available. So like I said, let's jump right into it. Here's our introduction to branding. This isn't really going to take very long. I'm going to kind of skip through this real quick. But you know, back in the day, whenever you talked about and you thought about branding was something that farmers and ranchers out in the West, they went and they wanted to go and they wanted to identify their cows by putting, you know, actual brands and marks on their cattle. It was something that over time everybody started knowing that, hey, this guy over here has the best cattle, and I want to look for all of the cattle that have like this guy's brand on it. And so over time, the word branding started to get associated with quality as sort of a mark of quality. But today, it's now when it's a marketing term that is, you know, generally associated with something that in terms of the feeling and emotions that are associated with a company or a product. And we have some examples here, but you know, it's why you call something a Kleenex, you use a Kleenex instead of a tissue, or you pay so much for a cup of coffee, or you know, you use a Tylenol instead of acetaminophen or whatever it is. But you know, there's a lot of value in every company that you all work for. You know, has a very important association with their brand, and they want to make sure that, especially when they're making their websites, that those feelings and emotions are coming through their web properties, so that you know people understand. You know, this is us. This is our brand. This, you know, it all kind of fits together and it works. So when you think about branding on a website, you're talking about the colors, fonts, logos, graphics. You know, all the stuff that generally goes into the UI and making something look like something. Really anything that's on the screen.
Yep, pretty much.
So when we talk about branding for SharePoint, we're talking about some more specific objects. Master pages, page layouts, CSS, there's CSS obviously in regular website branding, but for the most part, there's very specific SharePoint CSS that's important to reference here. Web parts, images, apps, all of those types of things are all, you know, going into bringing all of that together is what composes the SharePoint branding, or everything that's in SharePoint branding. We often will use it interchangeably with UX design or UX development. So if you ever hear those terms, UI, UX development, branding, they're kind of all, I mean, there's, if we want to get academic, there's differences between everything, but they're all kind of generally within the same ballpark. So for the people that are in the room here, how many of you are still using SharePoint 2010? See, that's kind of what I thought. There's a lot of people that are still using SharePoint 2010. So when you're talking about branding in SharePoint 2010, this is what you're talking about. We're talking about our low, medium, and full effort. And so on the low side of things, you're talking about just page editing. You're talking about themes. These are the basically no-code things that you do through the browser. You go in, you make changes, and it's pretty easy. You can do it in minutes maybe, right?
Mm-hmm.
On the medium side of things, you're talking about doing some custom CSS. You're talking about, you know, overriding some styles and kind of changing some colors here and there and repositioning this or that. But medium effort traditionally at least would be done with SharePoint Designer. I would say it's low, no code. It's no code, low code kind of stuff.
Lots of CSS. If you think CSS is code, then it's code.
Yeah, so I mean, it's really not too bad. But then full effort is everything else. That's custom master page, custom CSS, custom page layouts, XSLT, which is everybody's favorite, and then, you know, everything in between. So I mean, if you can design it and you want to create something custom, the full effort is the way that you go. Now, if we fast forward to SharePoint 2013, and we're talking specifically, whether it's SharePoint 2013 or whether we're talking about SharePoint Online, it's really kind of the same set. But you still have the low effort. Themes are now called composed looks. We're going to talk about that a little bit. But the low effort is still page editing. The low effort is still composed looks. The medium effort there, you notice that we've highlighted that medium effort in gray around the arrow there. And that arrow has actually gotten longer because there's more things that you can do in the medium effort. But the difference with the medium effort here is that the medium effort uses Design Manager for the sites and allows you to do custom CSS and background images and things like that. But there's it's a little bit more intense. I would say that it's where before we were talking in the medium range, we were talking about almost little to no code. There's still code involved here. It's just mostly going to be HTML and CSS. And we're going to talk about Design Manager as we get in there. But in that medium range, there's a lot more that you can do now, which is great, especially for your if any of you are designers familiar with HTML and CSS, it's a little bit easier to get going. On the full effort, same deal. Full effort, you basically, it's everything above the medium effort. The difference is that you now have, rather than XSLT, you're now talking about display templates, which gives you a little bit more control and flexibility to make some of those roll-ups, whether it's with like search,
Content search web part.
Content search and things like that. That is currently, and we'll talk about this, but display templates is going to be a primarily something that you would look at in the on-prem stuff.
Yes.
But it's worth calling out. Let's jump into public sites. So if you're familiar with SharePoint Online, with Office 365, you have a couple different options of the plans. And these just sort of I don't even know how many SKUs there's a ton of them. But they're basically broken out into two groups. There's the small business plan, and then there's the enterprise plan. So small business plans are really designed for small businesses, up to 25 employees, single site collection, and you still have that one public site.
Yep.
On the enterprise side, you get a little bit more flexibility. As you heard in the keynote, they were talking about infinite scalability and things like that. So we have a lot more flexibility on the enterprise plans to do more. It's a little bit closer to what you would say, a lot of you guys that are on SharePoint 2010, what you would all be used to. You can turn on the publishing, you can do create all kind of different site collections and everything, but you still only get one public site.
One public site, yep.
So,
and if you have questions about those plans, go talk to Microsoft. They're very confusing for us to talk about what's in one plan versus another plan, because there's so many of them. So what is a public site? It's your one public-facing website option you have with SharePoint Online. So you can't really host a public site on like the intranet type of stuff that they give you. And so you get one by default with each of the setups, and it's either going to be like I have there, yourname-public.sharepoint.com, or you can get a custom domain name, wire that up so it's like, johnswaffles.com would go to your public site. And it's similar to a SharePoint server publishing site, but there's differences that we're going to cover, a little bit of the differences. It's not exactly a publishing site, it just has things you might be used to in a publishing site. But essentially they've removed anything that's not focused on working on a public-facing website. So all the menus are dropped out that don't have to do with a public-facing site. And so that's pretty much the big difference. So like I said, the site settings menu, the options are focused on public sites, so there's only like 25 options in the menu versus like I counted 63 in a regular intranet site, so you can see that there's a good bit less. And so it's all, again, focused on what you would want to do for a public website. And then I'm going to demo some of this in a little bit, but it includes a site tab on the ribbon, which is mostly shortcuts to stuff you could already do, but it sort of helps you to work with a public-facing website a little easier than the regular editing menus that come with SharePoint on-prem. It has a simple way to add CSS into things. There is, if you're familiar with what device channels are, that's sort of how you could handle mobile devices coming to your site. The SharePoint Online public site only has one device channel. You can't make your own, and it's just mobile. And so they've figured out, I'm not really sure what the equation is, but they've decided what equates to a mobile device, and you could pick that device channel and change your look based on whether it's a mobile device or not a mobile device. It also includes an editable header and footer elements, which I think is really cool. I wish they had that in on-prem SharePoint and on, you know, regular 365 sites. It's only available on a public site and basically allows you to edit a header and a footer in edit mode, like your site owners can do that, and it persists across all the pages, which I think is great. Like, that should be everywhere. And then there's a button to take the site offline or online, so like if legal comes by and says, you know, John said something dumb on the website, we gotta take it down immediately, you just click that button and it goes offline.
You mean if it's Tuesday or something?
Exactly. And the other kind of, I guess, the downside you could say is there's no content query web part, no content search web part. There's probably other web parts that are missing as well, honestly, but those are the two big ones, in my opinion, that if you're doing a public-facing site, you might want to have a content query web part or a content search web part. So that's sort of something you have to get by without if you're going this route. Is it demo time? Ooh, that's fun.
It is demo time.
All right, swap me over. Number five. He's alive.
Did I do it?
Yeah, I think we're up. Okay.
All right, that's it for me.
So for this demo, all I'm really showing you is just what is in a public site, because I imagine even those that are on 2010 have seen 2013, right? And so this is what's different if you haven't seen a public site, right? And you can see this is what you would get if you started a public site today. It's got these clouds in the background, et cetera. So I haven't really done much to modify it at this point, right? And so you can see it already looks kind of different than a normal SharePoint site. I'll head over to the site settings real quick, and I'll show you what I meant by there being less options here. You know, you've got some stuff for managing people. You've got some of the designer galleries like master pages and page layouts, themes, composed looks. You've got things to manage the search and the help settings. And then you've got the look and feel stuff, which is what you would normally get in a publishing site, which is why I say it bears a strong resemblance to a publishing site. And then there's some regional settings and search down here as well. So those are like the main differences with the site settings.
I counted. There is 25. You got it right.
Awesome. I counted well. Like I said, there's this button up here that lets me take the site online and offline. I have it offline right now, just in case you guys would all just like hit it at once and like crash my 365 account, which they say you can't really do or whatever. But you know, an extra amount of caution. After the session, I'll turn it online. If you guys want to go to spc14waffles-public.sharepoint.com, you could see the site or whatever. The other big thing that it's got is if I go over here, you know, in a regular SharePoint ribbon, you've got the browse and the page, but if I click on site, this is sort of different. This is stuff that you wouldn't normally see. A lot of these are shortcuts to other things. Change the look just takes us to the composed looks menu. I'm not going to click it right this second. Edit title just lets us edit this title very easily. Change logo lets us change this blue logo here. Edit menu is the same exact thing as clicking this edit links button, so I think it's kind of dumb, but it's there anyways. Edit site elements is very interesting. I'm going to click that one. When I click that, you'll see that this header area becomes editable and this footer area becomes editable, and I can start typing in stuff, you know, in there, you know, like hello SPC or whatever, and then when I save the page, that's going to persist down there across whatever page I go to. And that was kind of what I was saying. I really wish they had that in regular SharePoint. A lot of our customers ask for that sort of thing all the time. So that's kind of nifty. Other than that, other differences that you have with a public site is when you go over to change the look, and which we'll talk about in a little bit, there's extra looks in here for various types of small to medium-sized businesses like construction, coffee. If you happen to be running a coffee shop, that might be a good one for you. Or if you're running a golf shop, that one might be good for you. But they have several in there that are geared towards various industries. So that's kind of cool, I guess. And then the other interesting thing is there's extra master pages. And so for those of you that don't know, master pages control like the outside, the shell of your design, the overall, you know, general look of your website, right? And so you'll see I have a few in here, RD, that are some that I've added in. You can ignore those. But all the rest of them are things that you get by default in a SharePoint Online public site. And if you've looked in a SharePoint 2013 site, you'll notice that it only has Seattle and Oslo normally. You'll see here there's also Berlin, Lyon, Tokyo, and then Oslo Mobile, Berlin Mobile, Lyon Mobile, and Tokyo Mobile. And they're really not that different from each other. They kind of just move the menus around and stuff like that. Like I'll pick Lyon real quick just to see what it looks like. Actually, I don't even remember what it looks like, but if I go over to it, okay, it put the menus on the right. All right, that's kind of cool, I guess. But you can see they're fairly similar to the other ones. But it does give you more options. The other cool thing I was mentioning, this device channel here, any mobile device, we can either have it so that when a mobile device comes to our site, it'll just follow default channel, which means it would show the one I've got picked here, Leon. Or I could say, you know, instead, show one of these mobile ones here. And just, I don't want to bring up a mobile device because we don't have, like, the ability to show you that. But, like, if I pick Leon Mobile and apply it, you can see kind of what it would look like if we came to it on a device. And if I go, whoops, if I do this, you can see it's got this little thing here where the menu sort of responds a little bit to my movements, which is kind of nice. And so you could, you know, you could pick that and have that be your default for when someone comes to your site on a cell phone or on a tablet or what have you. And so I think that's pretty much it for the tour, if you want to switch back, and then I'll reset the website back to normal for the next demo.
All right, so when you're talking about SharePoint Online public sites, what kind of sites can you make? Kind of as we were saying, there's tons of cool stuff that you can do, lots of powerful features, but there's some caveats here. So it's generally geared towards smaller, more brochure sites, and we'll help you, you know, later on in the session, we'll try to give some context to what that specifically means. You can make, but pretty much, I mean, if you've got a design idea, you can probably make it work in SharePoint public sites if you're willing to spend the time. And I think that that's one of the key takeaways is sometimes you've just really got to consider your scenario and the amount of effort that you're going to spend to see if it makes sense to put it in SharePoint in the SharePoint Online public sites. But, you know, there are less settings and control that you have. So you really just need to consider your options and your scenario about what's going to make the most sense for you. But, you know, there are a few examples of really cool SharePoint Online public sites.
I just want to, like, give a caveat or however you say that word to this. I just wanted to show you only SharePoint Online public sites, right? So I wasn't able to find a lot that people have admitted that they actually created in SharePoint Online public sites. So if we just, like, wanted to show SharePoint sites that are on the web, you know, you could go to topsharepoint.com and look at all their examples that they have on there. They kind of archive cool websites. But these are just ones that I know for sure are running in a public site on SharePoint Online.
Yes.
So this one is actually, like, if you go to microsoftofficedemos.com, I don't think you actually see this UI. But what's on there is if you're a partner, I believe, or an MVP, or you have special access, you can download, or I'm sorry, you click on it, and you could create trial 365 accounts that are loaded with demo content in them. And this is the default public site that it creates for it. And it's sort of like a restaurant website or something like that.
Looks different.
It does look different. This is one that I think is actually a really cool site that another MVP that we know worked on.
He's actually going to be presenting about a session, if it hasn't already happened.
He may have already. So definitely check out that session. Todd Baginski, I don't know what the title or the number of the session is, but he's talking about how he built, or his team built, whymicrosoft.com, which is actually a pretty nifty little site if you check it out, and it's sort of responsive and jQuery-y, and it looks like a modern, any website you'd see on the internet or whatever, and they're using public site, they're using Azure, they're using a number of different technologies to make it exist. And then here is a fake website that you will not find on the internet, but is what we are going to be trying to demo to you a little bit later, is the Randy's Waffle website, which I sort of just tried to make something that looks hipster and modern and is responsive and that kind of thing, and is focused on what I love, which is eating and waffles and things like that.
Is that your arm? That's your arm, isn't it?
It's actually not my arm. That is public domain stock photography right there.
All right, so kind of jumping into composed looks. A lot of you guys, about most of the room, raise their hand whenever I ask who's on SharePoint 2010. So in SharePoint 2010, you had themes. And when you think about themes in SharePoint 2010, you make them using the THMX files. You go into your Office client. You can go and kind of pick some colors, and you pick like a dozen colors, and SharePoint does all kind of crazy things for it. It basically allowed you to just reskin SharePoint in a very limited way.
Mm-hmm.
Let's call it limited way. You didn't have very much of the ability to reposition things or do a lot of the things that most people
the
wanted.
The big thing it was lacking in 2010 was background images, which when you see the composed looks in 2013, you'll see they rely heavily on background images to make them look cool. And so that's something that was really lacking in 2010.
But in it was almost like if you thought about themes in SharePoint 2007, they were almost, they required you to go in and change things on the server itself. You go to SharePoint 2010, they actually went way the other direction and said, you know what, we're going to make it so you don't have to change things on the site. But they took away a lot of the flexibility. So with composed looks in 2013, Microsoft really, I think, hit the sweet spot, hit it right in the middle of the two things. And so you have the ability to go in and kind of pick some of these themes that allow, and we'll show you some of the options there, but it gives you a lot more flexibility to make changes in a safe way.
Yep.
They can really do, you know, you can really change the look of your site pretty in a cool way. So here's an example of some of the composed looks. I'm sure that you can't see every single one of them.
I just showed this to you, so I mean, that's sort of redundant. But again, there's a lot of small business focused looks that you can pick from.
What's your favorite these days?
I don't think it's on the public site, but I like that Sea Monster one. But there's actually one that's got like some breakfast foods on it, kind of, that I think is nifty. And so that's always good. It's actually right there. You can see it in the background of that image. It's got like some dates or something, I don't know, and some cinnamon. I don't know if anyone actually eat that or not. But so the way, you know, the composed looks is you can go in there and you can pick from sort of predefined composed looks. So you go to settings, change a look. I'll do a demo in a second to show you how we do this. But the cool thing is you don't have to just stick with what is the options there. You can start changing things out on the fly. You can add your own background image. You can pick from the colors that are in the dropdown. You can actually add your own colors, your own fonts, things like that if you want to get fancy. There's something in there called site layout, which is sort of confusing terminology. It's talking about a master page. And you'll, I don't know if you can see it on the screen, but you'll probably better see it in my demo. When I switch those, it says Oslo and Seattle and that kind of thing. That's how you know. Obviously, that's a master page, but for some reason, they dumbed it down and called it a site layout there. And so that's moving things on the page because the master page is changing. And then if you hit the next there, you kind of covered that already. They're not created in the Office client. In 2010, you did use the Office client to create your own themes. And so now, instead, what you do is to create your own composed looks. I'll show you this. There was another session earlier in the day where they've deep dove into this idea. And so if you really want to learn how to create your own, I definitely recommend you check out that session because they spent the whole hour just talking about how to do this. But essentially what you're doing is you're going into a gallery and you're adding XML files for the colors and the fonts. And then there's another gallery that's sort of a list where you set what the default background image is, default colors, default font, default master page. And this is a screenshot of those two menus side by side to kind of show you how you would set it up. And it's a little bit confusing again because one of the things uses terminology that I would use, like master page, you know, and page URL, image URLs, things like that. And then the other one, the change look menu, is I guess for more for users, right? You know, so like the one on the left is for, you know, maybe you guys might be creating your own composed looks, so that's a little bit more technical, so it uses the actual technical terms. The one on the right, more user focused, so they've dumbed down sort of the terminology to make it straightforward. But those two things definitely relate exactly to each other. So let's do a demo and take a look.
This is the point where I push 5.
Number 5.
Boom.
All right, so this is our default look again. But what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go over here to change the look. And there's a number of different ways you can get to change the look. It's in that menu, it's in the site menu I showed you, it's also in site settings as well. But again, you know, what you could do here is we could pick one that we like. I'll pick that crazy breakfast one that I was mentioning before, if I can find it right here. And like the way it works is that somebody went through and they set up a composed look that said there's this background, there's these colors, it's going to use Oslo, and it's going to use CGO font. But we could go in here and we could change all this. If we don't like the way it looks, we can make it look brown, blue, whatever, right? We could change the way the master page is applied to it. And you can see here, that changes it dramatically because the master page controls exactly what the site looks like. So you might want it to look more like this, where it's in the middle versus you know, all the way across the page, how Oslo looks. And so you've got a number of choices you can pick from here. And then you can also pick from some fonts that have been defined that are easy to bring up or whatever. And so what you could do is when you've got something you like, you could click try it out. And then you get this fun working on it where we wait for it. You could click this little spinning thing if you get bored, and that makes it disappear. I don't know why that's there. I really don't. Somebody told me it was for like accessibility and you know, handicapable stuff. I don't know. But when you click it, it disappears. And so when you do this, though, you get a nice little preview. So you can like say, I like that, or no, not quite there. And so you can say, yes, keep it. And when you say, yes, keep it, it thinks again for a little bit. If I could click on it. I don't know. There we go. I know what's going on there. But you can see, you know, now my site looks entirely different, right? That's pretty cool. But what we can really want to do, though, is we want to make our own look and feel on this thing, right? And so what we could do here is we can click on the current one, and I can change this background image to be a background image that, you know, I want to use. And so if I go to my desktop here, and then I go down to demos, I have a background image, which is breakfast themed, of course. Click that, puts it in the background, so we can see that, what that's going to look like. And then we could say, we don't like those colors. Let's pick these gray colors are nice. And then, you know, I don't know if I like Oslo. Let's leave it on Oslo. And then we could change this to Rockwell font, which is kind of this sort of typewritery font, which I think is kind of nice and hipstery or whatever. And then we can go try it out again. If we get excited, we can click that. Love that feature.
I always say that, like, you want to teach the audience at least one thing in your session.
That's your one thing right there.
Man, they're going to go back and they're going to tell their bosses, I learned so much at SPC from John and Randy.
In demos, I really wish this would go just a tad bit faster, but hey, you know, beggars can't be choosers. Okay, so we have something pretty cool there, right? But we can also swap out the logo if we want. What we could do here is we can go to this site menu, and we can go change the logo, and if you had 2010, this wasn't like an option here from computer, which I think is great. So I don't have to like first upload my logo to like a gallery or whatever and then do all that kind of jazz. I can just pick it from right here. It gives me a little preview of it. I click OK. Everybody's happy. You know, we can go back to browse. And now we've got a logo. We've got a background. We've got a site that's been branded. When you click the logo, it goes back to the home. We can go around. And we've actually got something, I think, that looks kind of halfway decent. If we wanted to, we could stop right here and we'd have a website that was kind of okay. Or we could take it further if we would like. And we'll probably do that in a little bit. So if we want to switch it back, though, I'll just show you real quick how we switch it back, since it's a little bit confusing how you switch it back. In the old way, there was a different way that this worked. But you just click on this default one here, and that takes you back to the normal look and feel. And so I'm not going to click on it in the demo, but that's how you would reset everything if you didn't like what you had created.
So everything that you just showed, applicable to on-prem?
Most of it. Like when I click that shortcut menu, that's not there in on-prem, but everything else. And also some of those background images, like that breakfast one, aren't there. But the ideas are all identical to an on-prem setup.
So you pretty much achieve the same results.
I think so, yeah.
All right, so now we're going to hop into medium branding. And we have a question in the back. Yes.
Yeah, actually, if you switch me back real quick, I'll show.
Going back to five.
Back to five. The question was, can you like name it or whatever? What you could do, I didn't really show this part. Like, this is what you could go watch that other session where they dive deep on this idea. But over here on the left, under Web Design Galleries, there's Composed Looks. And this is where all the ones that we just saw that we picked from are created. And so you could see, like, polka dot, paper, ornament, orange, maritime. Those are the names of all of them. So if we wanted to create one, you know, we could just go in here and set up a new one. And you can see what you do here is you kind of point it to the catalog's master page, Oslo, and then you point it to this color file, you point it to a JPEG, point it to a font file, and that sets up what the default one is. So you could add your own in there, and then you would kind of have one of the options would be in there. And then the only other thing I'll point out real quick is that if you wanted to add your own color and fonts, those are confusingly enough under themes, under Web Design Galleries. Terminology is not Microsoft's strong suit, I feel. And if you then, for some reason, it's tucked under 15 here, is if you click on 15, this is where all the font schemes and palettes are. What I would do if I were you is I would download one, which you go like right here and say download a copy, and then edit it, because it's sort of a special XML file that's formatted, you know, for computers to read, not for humans to read. And so that way you could just go in there and change colors and things like that rather than try to invent the XML file yourself.
Cool. Good question. All right, so hopping back. Talking about Design Manager, as this is that medium effort of branding. And so back in 2010 and before, there was a lot of times that, and this kind of almost goes back to the first time that I ever met Randy, when we were working. We've worked together for I don't even know how many years. Let's call it 8.
It's adding up.
So when we worked together doing a public-facing site, one of the things that he came from a non-Microsoft background, and he's trying to do some custom branding in SharePoint, and he wanted to get rid of an element on his custom master page. So he did what a lot of normal people would do, is he found the element that he wanted, and he removed it, and then he tried to upload his master page, and he got a big fat error. And he was like, why does it error all the time whenever I want to do normal things? So I think that was a common experience that a lot of designers had. And so Microsoft had this idea that they said, you know, we want to make it easier for traditional designers to be able to come in and work with SharePoint. We want to be able to, you know, if you know HTML and CSS, we want to help you get started making things in SharePoint without having to worry too much about, you know, all of the placeholders and a lot of the other codey stuff that's going on the master pages that can cause people to stumble. So they had this really ambitious design of creating something which ended up being the design manager. And you know, I think in a lot of ways it does help people get a little bit farther down the process than just the old way of doing things, the old traditional way of doing things. But so when you do it, when you're looking for the design manager, you can find the design manager in your public site under the site settings menu. Mm-hmm. If you're doing on-prem, it's a similar location. If you do have on-prem, it does require publishing, so you need to make sure that you have SharePoint server, and you need to make sure that you're using a site template that has the publishing features enabled, or turn them on yourself, and as soon as you turn them on, you'll get all that lit up. But it basically allows you to kind of focus on the HTML and CSS, and it'll help create the master page for you. And you can even create that stuff in a text file and import it, and it'll do all the magic of kind of getting a working something in SharePoint. There's some caveats to that, and we'll kind of show that here in a second. But it's a good start. There's also some tools for working with page layouts in a similar fashion to the same thing that's available in master pages that have what would be called a snippet gallery, so that it kind of has some code samples. So if you're, you know, trying to create something, you don't need to just magically know the syntax for a search box. You can kind of say, I need a search box, and it generates it for you.
For those that don't know, master page, again, outer shell of your design, page layout, inner layout. So, you know, like, you want to have a two-column layout, that's a page layout. Master page puts your navigation, your search, your logo, your footer, all that jazz. And so that's sort of the difference of those two.
So again, if you're familiar with 2010, like a lot of you are, SharePoint Designer was the primary tool for editing content and doing branding work. I mean, it was really the starting place for everything for a very long time, even for Randy. I mean, a lot of people say, you know, would kind of, you know, shake their head at about SharePoint Designer, but right. The reality is that
it was the fastest way to get in and work with the files and that kind of thing.
So in SharePoint 2013, Microsoft still has SharePoint Designer, but they got rid of the Design View, which was a WYSIWYG editor that allowed people to go in and kind of move elements around and see them directly on the page. A lot of people didn't like that. Design Manager has been the answer for you know, the replacement, I guess you could say, for the Design View.
It's not a one-for-one replacement. I know some folks in the audience I've talked to recently that are not happy with the fact that Design View is not there in SharePoint Designer anymore, but that's sort of the answer that Microsoft has.
So the theory is that designers didn't necessarily use SharePoint Designer. A traditional web designer is going to use other tools such as, you know, Dreamweaver or
Expression Web,
Notepad, Notepad++, any of those types of things. So Microsoft's idea was that designers should be able to use their tool of choice. And the way that designers typically did design work and made changes for sites was basically finding a drive and then just updating the files in that drive, and you know, it just magically show up on the site. And so they came up with this idea that you could map a drive in Office 365, or you know, on-prem it works too. Yep. So you go to the master page gallery, you map the drive, you have access to your files right there, and you make the changes right, and you just hit save, and changes are there. So I should say, we always like to point out that that you can use any tool of choice, including Front Page or Hot Dog Pro, which I don't know if there's anybody in the audience that is familiar with Hot Dog Pro. I heard several chuckles, but.
Way back in the day, that program was the bomb back in the day.
I did actually do a search once to see if Hot Dog Pro existed, and the site, I believe, is still there. It doesn't look like anybody's using anything. But anyway, so in Design Manager, all the master pages and page layouts are essentially going to be HTML-based.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, essentially what you're going to do is you're going to be editing HTML, and it's when you hit save, it's going to be updating a master page. And so there's a couple ways you could get started with it. You could say, go into Design Manager and say, create me a new minimal master page, right? And that sort of just gives you the basics in order to get a site kind of up and running, right? Or what you can do, which is really cool, is you can convert an existing HTML design into a functioning master page. And now, that kind of sounds cooler than it really is, but it still is extremely helpful. Like, it kind of implies that your job is done after you click that button, and that's not exactly the case. But it is there nonetheless. And so once you've got this going, let's say you've converted an HTML file to a master page, what happens is you upload it, you have an HTML file, and then SharePoint creates a master page file, and you edit the HTML one. Every time you make a change, it updates the .master file. So you always edit the HTML, and then it updates the master file. And so that's the same way the page layouts would work. You could create page layouts that way as well. And we're going to demo that in a second. And so, you know, I mentioned that, you know, the master page is your shell that holds everything together, right? And so let's say you've converted your HTML design into this master page, right? Well, SharePoint isn't smart enough to know where you wanted the navigation to be and where you wanted the search box to be and where you wanted login to be and web parts and headers and footers and all that kind of jazz. And so your next step after converting it is you have to put that functionality into the HTML master page. And so back in the olden days, what you had to do was read a book or read a bunch of blogs and learn what all those controls were and how you registered them at the top of the master page, then added them and hoped you did it right and didn't blow everything up. And so in the design manager, what they did is they've given us what's called a snippet gallery. And so it's got a lot of the common functionality you would normally see in a SharePoint site. You got navigation, breadcrumbs, search box, title, logo, sign-in, web parts, headers and footers, probably a bunch of other stuff too, right? And when you pick one, it gives you an HTML snippet. And it's a commented out HTML. It looks kind of like, if you can see the screen there at the bottom left, it looks like that. It's kind of ugly. They don't mean for you to ever read that snippet. It's not necessarily very human readable. What it does is, if you were editing this in, since it's HTML now, so if you're editing this in Dreamweaver, they needed something so that if you put it in your HTML, Dreamweaver wouldn't barf on it, right? And so it's like a commented out thing, so Dreamweaver skips over the comment, right? But then SharePoint can read that comment and know that it needs to put the SharePoint functionality right there. And then it also includes a preview, which in some cases is just an image, and in other cases is a bit of HTML with some styling. And so that when you load this into Dreamweaver and you go into like the design view, it shows you something that at least resembles what's going to go into that area. Now, it's not exactly what goes in that area, so that can be kind of confusing and hard to deal with at times. But at least it's kind of moved you to the point where you don't have to memorize what all these things are. And so we're going to show you that in a demo in a little bit. But so the demo that we're going to show you is that Randy's Waffle site that I was talking about. And in this demo, it's HTML5 and CSS3 is what it's based on. And I'm not going to go too much. I'll fly through the file real quick. I'm going to assume people know HTML and CSS. If you don't, you know, feel free to read up on it and then come back and listen to the session again or something like that. But we could spend all day probably talking about that because that's actually where a lot of the functionality of the demo is sitting in HTML and CSS3. It doesn't involve SharePoint very much. There's also responsiveness to this design. So we're using media queries for that, and that's a CSS3 concept. And so when we resize the page, things will change dynamically. We're using web fonts that I thought were cool. One is called Lobster 2, and one is called Bitter, and they're from whatever that word is, G something fonts.
We're not allowed to say that. We're told we're not allowed to say that.
We weren't actually told, but you know what?
It's more fun to say that.
It is more fun to say that. And then there's also jQuery involved, and there's something called a flow type plugin, which I use, which really all that does is it's just going to make text get bigger and smaller as you resize the page. I thought that was kind of a fancy, fun thing to do. And so we're going to try to make that happen in SharePoint. And if all goes well, maybe we'll achieve something interesting.
So I'll say this. This demo that we're doing right now is pretty much going to be, at this point, almost one-for-one identical to if you did have on-prem.
Yes.
You know, so if you did have on-prem, you had access to publishing, or you even were not doing this in a public context, you were doing it for an intranet site on Office 365. Basically exact same process.
Yes. So here is my HTML design. Right at this point, we are not using SharePoint. At this point, I've created a design using Notepad++, Dreamweaver, the things that I like to use to make websites. We have an HTML file. We have a style file. We have some JS, we have some responsive stuff, we have background images, et cetera, et cetera. We have that flow type thing I was talking about. All that stuff has kind of come into play here. I have I have this local.html. The only reason I have that is just to demo this without having to have IIS loaded on this box or whatever. So local and SPC waffles are basically the same file, but I'm going to click on this local one because otherwise it would kind of freak out trying to load jQuery and things like that. So here's what the design looks like. You know, it's not, you know, the most exciting design in the world, but I think it matches what is a popular look these days of sort of having something that expands across the whole page, you know, has some color blocking and some big photos and things like that. And if I resize the page, you can see that some things start to happen. The fonts, it's probably hard to tell, but the fonts are getting smaller as I do that. And then when we hit a certain point, the responsive kicks in, and that is what I would expect it to look like on a mobile phone if you went to it. And so really, all that's happening in CSS again. And so, you know, there's a little bit of jQuery, a little bit of CSS. And so if we pop the hood on those files real quick that make some of the magic happen, I'll do a quick tour through them. Can we see those fonts? I think that's kind of readable. Should I bump it up a little more? A little better? Okay. Again, this is just an HTML5 file. There's nothing special about it. No magic going on. In order to make the responsive work, we have a viewport. We load our styles up. We load in our Google fonts here. We load in the jQuery. We load in some other jQuery. We load in the flow type. And then we get to the body content of the page, where it's just, you know, I try to keep things pretty simple with divs, with classes. You may want to do it a different way. I don't know. And, you know, it's just basically HTML. And then I bring in, there's this waffle init, and all that does is just call the flow type library to make it so the text gets bigger and smaller.
But this is probably something that, like, any HTML designer or whatever would be able to crank.
If you're an HTML person, you should be able to do this sort of stuff, right? Okay. And then the style file, the CSS file is just typical CSS. We have some web fonts in here that load in the, that special font that I was talking about. And then it's just typical CSS. And then for the responsive stuff, what you'll see here, if I scroll down far enough, is you'll start to see media queries, right? And here's one. There's one at sort of the 700 pixel mark, and then there's another one that kicks in at 568 pixels, which is what I assume to be, you know, a cell phone type size, right? And so basically what happens is, if you haven't seen how media queries work, is in CSS 3, if a small screen comes to this site, that's the only time it's going to kick off the stuff that's within this section of the CSS. And so all the other CSS is going to apply normally, and then a small screen comes to it, and then this stuff kicks in. And that's when you see the design change from this to this, is when that kicks in right there. All right? So that's all basic stuff, right? So now let's see if we can make that work in SharePoint. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to map a drive to my SharePoint site. And I already have it mapped just because it can be finicky. And if it fights you, I don't want to ever have to fight that in a demo. But what you would do is, if you load up your File Explorer or whatever and you right-click on this PC, you could do Map a Network Drive. And then you just paste in the URL for your site. Now, before you do that, though, make sure you log in with IE into your site, authenticate, and say, remember who I am. I mean, that's sort of key to getting this to work. And if you have more problems with it later, there's a link in the deck that for troubleshooting. That can be very frustrating. But once you get it mapped, it shows up in here like this. And then you see you've got sort of like, if you were in SharePoint Designer back in the old days, in the bottom left, you had a view that was very similar to this. And so now we're in my SharePoint Online site collection at this point, right? And so I want to put things in the master page gallery, which is located in catalogs master page. And so that catalogs folder is a hidden folder, by the way. So you'll want to make sure you have that button ticked to say show hidden folders or whatever. Otherwise, you might not see that. And then this is something that's a little bit different in the public site. For whatever reason, there are all these language libraries in there for different locales. And so you'll just have to kind of ignore that unless you're from one of those locales or what have you. You wouldn't have that in a normal on-prem site. What I like to do is I like to create a folder to put my stuff in. That way it's sort of self-contained. And so I've put things in this demo folder. And now this is another thing that I'm not going to do in the demo just because this is somewhere where it can go haywire on you if you're not careful. But all I really did was I went in here and I selected all these files and I dragged them over into that folder. And you'll see it goes a little bit slower than a local connection because we're going up to the webs.
The cloud.
The clouds, so to speak, and each one kind of ticks in. I practiced this demo on our flight over here on the in-flight wireless. I do not recommend you do that. It is extremely slow.
The cloud and the clouds.
Yes, and I like to name my HTML file not index.html because it's going to use that to name my master page, and it's kind of dumb to have a master page named index, because you might have three or four of them all named index. So give them a cool name that makes sense to you, right? Okay, so we've uploaded all those into there. They're all in the site, right? And that's where the magic is going to happen, hopefully, now. Okay, so we've got our basic site. It looks like it always did before. Here's where we're going to try to make that work in SharePoint, so to speak. So if we go to site settings, we go over here to Design Manager. When you go into Design Manager, there's some instructions on how to map the drive. It's a little different. They tell you to go into the themes folder. I don't like the way they do that, but nonetheless, there's instructions on how to do it there. But if you look over here on the left, there's a bunch of steps. We're just going to jump right over here to Edit Master Pages. Okay? And you'll see that there are some in there. I should delete this one because that's confusing, because that's what we're going to be doing. Hopefully I don't mess anything up. I'm going to try to delete that one so you don't see that. Okay. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go over here. I could do a minimal master page, like I said. I'm going to convert an HTML file into a SharePoint master page. And so what it does is it brings us up a view of that folder we were just looking at. I put this stuff in demo. Okay? And then what it's going to do is it's showing me HTML files that have not already been converted to a master page. And so there's only one in there, SPC Waffles. And I kind of click next to it, because if you click right here on it, it tries to open it, which is dumb. So you click next to it, and then it puts it in this little URL. Then you click insert, which I don't know why it says insert there, but nonetheless it does. And then this is another confusing thing. It says, do you want to publish it now? And I always click yes. It really doesn't publish it. I don't really know what's happening right there. You'll notice what happened there is it showed up in this list. It says conversion successful, and you'll see it's in draft mode. That's how you know it's not published. I think what happens is it published it, and then it like edited it like right after it published it, and then so it's not published.
That makes sense.
It is what it is. And so if it failed, it would say like an error right there. And you could click that, and it would kind of try to help you figure out what the error is. And we have a slide that talks about some of the common errors you might see in there. But what I'm going to do real quick is I'm going to publish it so that I can actually pick it. And so it's under this little dot, 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 and then you click dot, dot, dot again, and then you click publish a major version.
So now you're publishing it.
Now I am actually publishing it. So that's cool. What I'm also going to do is I'm going to click on SPC Waffles, and I'm going to open it in a new tab. And what that gives me is that gives me this crazy preview view here, which tries to preview what your master page is going to look like if you applied it to your site. And you'll see it kind of looks cool, but you also see there's some funkiness down here. And you'll see that this is where the actual page content is, not where my page content is.
And this is the part that when we were writing the book, and Randy gave me a little bit of homework to go in and do this, and I got to hear. And so I think most of you, whenever you're going through this, and have no problem getting to here. So if you're curious about how to turn this into something real, like this is the meat and potatoes of the
sure.
Of this
and so what I like to do though is I don't like using that preview. I'm going to go apply the master page anyways to the site so I could just see it in real life, so to speak, right? And since I published it, I can do that. If you hadn't published it, it ain't going to show up right here. And so then I'm going to click on this, and it's going to think for a second. It's going to apply it to my site. I like to just look at the site and say, this is what it really looks like, right? It almost looks like our job is done, but it's not done. Down here is where the actual page content is. And so we're going to need to move that up into where the regular page content is. Also, this isn't the actual SharePoint navigation. This is my HTML fake navigation. So we want to put that in there as well. There's some other stuff we can do. How do we do that? We want to put snippets in there. And how do we get the snippets? There's only one way I know to get the snippets, and it's from this preview page. And that's why I left it open. Up here at the top, it says snippets. I like to open that in a new tab as well. And when I do that, it shows us all the things that we can put in the
snippets gallery is site. a bit tricky to get to.
It's got a lot of stuff. Look, I had to build all that junk you just saw right there. And so I'm going to try to blast through this because we don't have a ton of time or whatever. But what I'm going to do here is I'm going to grab like the navigation and some other things, and I'm going to grab this snippet, and I'm going to paste it into my HTML. And so what I'm going to do, though, is if I go over to the master page gallery, right, this is all the stuff I uploaded. If I hit refresh on that, what you'll see there is there's two files. Now there's SPC Waffles HTML, SPC Waffles Master. And if I click on those and, let me just open both of them up just so you can see them real quick. What's interesting is I'll show you the master page first. It created a SharePoint master page that, let me just do this so you can colorize it a little bit. I'm not going to really spend a whole lot of time, but it created a functioning master page, which is kind of cool, right? But we're not going to edit that. What we're going to edit is this HTML file. And what's interesting about that is you'll see that it looks different than my raw HTML file that we had before. So I recommend you keep an old copy of your HTML one in case this drives you bananas. But what it did was it added a bunch of comments in here that SharePoint knows how to read. And those are like the snippets that I was talking about. And so you'll see, if you're familiar with how master pages work, all these things are things that turn into stuff in master pages. And so you can kind of glance at this and kind of see what's going to happen when it turns this into a master page. And what I'm going to try to do real quick is make some changes so we can wire up some actual content here. If you remember at the bottom, it had the content was coming in a bad place where we didn't want it. So what I'm going to do is they actually put that content in here. I'm going to cut that. What I'm going to do is I'm going to paste it over where the content normally goes, which is right here, right? Fake content right now. So I'm going to go right here. I'm going to delete that. I'm going to paste that snippet in. And so now that snippet should appear in the div I wanted it to appear in. And then I'm going to grab the top navigation, which is what this is, and I'm going to say copy the snippet to clipboard. And then I'm going to go in here, and I'm going to find where the top nav is, which is right here. It's these fake items inside of this div right here. And I'm going to select that, and I'm going to delete that, and I'm going to paste this in. And that's going to put my navigation right there. And then what I also want to do is I want to put a header and footer in there. And so I'm going to click site element header. It thinks for a second, refreshes. I'm going to grab this snippet, copy to clipboard, allow access. And I'm going to go, what I'm going to do with that is I'm going to replace in that design where it had that text that was using that cool font, I'm going to replace it so that we can actually edit what goes into that area. And so that'll be the header right there. And the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to grab the footer, and it's going to think for a second, refresh. I'm going to copy that to the clipboard, allow access, do the same thing. I'm going to go down here to the bottom where it has this text, and I'm going to replace that with the actual snippet for the footer. And then I'm going to hit save, and hopefully everything doesn't blow up. What happened right there is it refreshed the master page that is associated with this HTML file.
And there's an event that fires off whenever it notices the change in the HTML file, and it kind of
does
exactly a new
right.
conversion. That's correct.
Yes.
So what she just said is you don't change the master page, the dot master page, you edit the HTML, and SharePoint will take care of the rest for you.
So if I did this right, when I hit F5 and refresh this, it will. It's still not perfect. We have more work to do, but now the navigation is live. That is real SharePoint navigation. That is what was in that header before. It had that sign-in thing. You can't see the footer because it's white, but it's sitting right there. Remember, I put Hello SPC in there. And then this is the page content, right? So now, at this point, we've got real content going in there. This is the hard part. Now you got to edit tons of CSS. I'm not going to do that in front of all of you. But what I am going to do is I'm going to show you real quick what my changes looked like. And so I've got a folder in here where I've got a pre-built CSS file. And the only changes I made are in these areas that I have commented that are for SharePoint. And so if I scroll down right here, SharePoint specific stuff, right here is where my SharePoint stuff kicks in. And a lot of it is probably confusing. This is where stuff gets really hard, where you might want to read a book and learn about it. But this is where I'm styling things where SharePoint wants to style it different than how it's going to show up on the page, right? And so that area right there is kind of some of all of the parts that I changed. And then I changed some of the responsive code at the bottom as well, right here, SharePoint stuff. I added in some stuff for when we resize it. I wanted those things to look special as well. Like, I'm not even going to apply that, but I just want to show you real quick that like right now, it's kind of doing it, but it's looking real bad, right? Not how we want it to look. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to go in here, and I'm going to edit the CSS file that lives on the server, and I'm going to just paste this over top of it, which is sort of like in food TV, when they bring out the turkey that's already baked, and you get to see a juicy turkey. You hit F5, everything went well. My site is starting to look like it's supposed to. What I could do now is I could edit this page, and I can just change what's in the header and footer section as well, which is pretty cool. So like I could go in here, and I could say, like, you know, Randy's waffles. It's going to look weird in edit mode, but when you save it, it's going to actually like look halfway decent, hopefully. And then, you know, you could put something down here that looks nice as well. And it's kind of taking the fonts that I had in there and using them, which is kind of fun. And so I don't know why that's blue right there. We'd have to fight with that a little bit. It's probably because there's a link in there. If I go site real quick, I'll try to fix it real quick just for not edit menu, edit site elements, leave this page. Yes.
That's a great question. She just asked, is there versioning on the HTML and the CSS stuff?
There is, because what you could do is check it in Everything I just showed you, there's going to be a slide that talks about this in a second. Right now, only I can see this stuff. No one else can see it. You're going to have to go in and publish all those assets before anyone can see it. And when you publish it, you're publishing a major version, and so that gives you version control. And so what I did right there is I took out some stupid link that for some reason SharePoint thought needed to be in that using the edit HTML mode or whatever. And so now we've got something that like persists across all pages. It's kind of fun, right? And then if we resize it, the responsive stuff kicks in. So that's pretty much that's the big demo right there. And so I hid a lot of stuff in that CSS part, but it's not that hard, right? If you understand HTML, CSS, a little bit of SharePoint, you can kind of make that stuff work.
And Randy went through this super fast. And so, I mean, this session is going to be recorded. You could try to keep up with that. But if you do check out the book, that we go into kind of the same concepts in the book, and there's example files and everything that you can download and do it yourself. So if you're interested in doing this, whether it's for a public site or whether it's for on-prem, you got lots of options. So
there's the overview of the steps. I'll go through it real quick because we have about 15 minutes left. But again, what I did was I created an HTML design. I mapped a network drive. There's the support link. If you have problems, go grab the deck later. That'll help you figure out problems in mapping the drive. I added my HTML, my images, my CSS. I used Design Manager to convert it to an HTML master page. Then we edited HTML. We added snippets. We customized CSS. We published all the files. We applied the master page to the site.
Whew,
a lot of work. A couple gotchas I'll go through real quick. If you're going to do an HTML design, check your doc type at the top. SharePoint likes it to be uppercase. Some folks that make templates make it in lowercase. So make it uppercase before you try to convert it or it'll blow up. Watch out for IE hacks, like this little commented thing where it says if less than IE8. That can choke it, so remove those as well. Embedded JavaScript on the page often gets commented out. And so what I did was I included a link to a JS file. That works a lot better. Watch out for HTTP and HTTPS references, because when you're logged into the public site, it only works in HTTPS. But when you go to it, when you say, hey, John, check out this cool work I did, he's going to go to it on HTTP, right, because he's an anonymous user. And you need that to work in both. And so there's a way you can do like a protocol relative reference link, //. Don't forget to publish all your files. Whew, it's fun.
All right, advanced branding, doing stuff the old-fashioned way.
Yeah, and so we're not going to get too far into this. There's other sessions at the conference that talk about advanced branding. I think Kathy Dew's session, I think, talks about some of this. I think Eric's session might as well. But essentially, the process is the same as it was for 2010. It's very similar to what I just did in Design Manager, only you've got to do the work now. And so there's nothing to create you a starter master page. You're not working with HTML. You're just working with a dot master. Go to my startermasterpages.codeplex.com, download that. That's your starter. And then what you do is you just go in, and instead of editing HTML, you got to know what all those snippets are that's going to get created on the back end and add those into the design the same way I did it in HTML, only you're not adding the commented snippet. You're adding the actual code that goes in there. And then most of the rest of the steps are the same.
All right, so if you want to do custom code, whether it's in on-prem, whether it's in SharePoint Online, apps are the way to do it moving forward. And so there's tons of sessions if you're a developer that, you know, show you how to get started with cloud development. So essentially, what is an app? It's self-contained functionality that's kind of like, I mean, kind of think of it almost as like the same way that apps work in Facebook or something like that. You know, it's something that you create. It could run on somebody else's server and kind of gets surfaced up into SharePoint and it can interact with your SharePoint data. So here's kind of the longer, more specific information. But the short version is you can use it to enhance your functionality. You can write your own, or you can use third-party apps, and there's plenty out there in the SharePoint SharePoint in the Office Store. But there's an important caveat here. If you're talking about public-facing sites or internet-facing sites, not all of the apps support anonymous users. So
right, just and there's not something in the store that'll tell you that. So you kind of have to just grab them and test it, and it'll blow up on you if it doesn't. That's how you deal with it. I went through and I found a couple apps that I thought were cool for public sites. There's probably others in there. These work anonymously. There's Bright Banner, which is a cool rotating type of jQuery banner that you can use, and you can just add your images into a list, and it rotates them. Location Finder is cool for mapping, like Google Maps and stuff. And our stock price puts a stock price on the page. Those are some fun ones you can do real quick.
So this is one of the things that I want to talk about. We're going to, in the next slide, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the difference, how you decide whether or not a public site is going to be good for you, or if you should go on-prem, if you're trying to make that decision. But I wanted to try to take a step back for a second and just make sure everybody understands that when we talk about cloud versus on-prem, what we're talking about, when we talk about cloud, cloud in the most simple sense means you're running on somebody else's server, whether that's Office 365, whether it's in Azure, whether it's at another provider like Rackspace or something like that. You have lots of, cloud is anyone else's server. There's different types of cloud. I'm not going to get into that. On-prem, though, has multiple meanings. So in a lot of times when people hear it, they think about it as a location. On-prem physically means like it's running in my data center at my company. But it also generally collectively refers to any build of SharePoint that is not SharePoint Online. So even if you are using Azure, for example, you are putting SharePoint in the cloud, but you are using an on-prem build of SharePoint. So I break this down. It's super confusing for me to just stand up here and try to explain all this. Take a look at the blog post that I wrote, the one that Randy claims that he read that he didn't actually read. But go to the website, and I try to break this down because I think that there's a lot of confusion out there. I think the cloud's a great thing, but I really think that it's easy to get caught up in some of the terminology because it gets pretty confusing just depending on who uses the terminology and what. But if you're trying to figure out, should I use a SharePoint Online public site, the answer could be yes, the answer could be no, the answer could be maybe. And so we broke this out. I'm not going to go point by point and read everything, but this will help you decide, when we talk about, you're looking to do like a small-scale brochure site, huge sweet spot for SharePoint Online public sites. It's really inexpensive and affordable for small companies to do public-facing sites like that. But if you're looking to do things like highly stylized, complex branding, cross-site publishing with
transactions, e-commerce, that
kind of
thing.
Yeah, or you want to do any of like the content query or content by search web parts, on-prem or a farm install is really going to be the better way for you to go. So take a look at this. Look at the slides after this if you're kind of on the fence about any of this. And we wanted to help kind of give people a guide on the thought process there. But just kind of wrapping up, what do we talk about? Lots of options for branding internet sites. No matter what your skill level is, whether you're looking for, just to do stuff out of the box, whether you're looking to do the full effort stuff or somewhere in between, no matter your skill level, no matter what your requirements, you should be able to figure out what's going to be the best combination and fit for you. And then, you're going to be able to figure out what environment's going to work best. There's lots of great options, whether you're talking about the SharePoint Online public sites or whether you're looking at something like on-prem with Azure or other options. So keep it all in mind and make sure that as you're, match your solution and match your requirements with the best platform and everybody will be happier. But please take a look at MySPC and go off and evaluate this session. Hopefully everybody enjoyed it. If you enjoyed it, please give us fives. If you didn't,
don't read it.
Pick another one.
Exactly.
but thanks, you guys. I hope you have a great rest of the week here, and we'll see you soon.